Hello and good evening. Welcome to Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship's online Bible study for this Wednesday, March 13th. Thank you for joining me once again in this virtual space as we open God's Word. For tonight's lesson, we have a guest teacher this evening. Our teacher is our youth pastor here at Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship, Brother Dari Crockett. So I pray that you will receive a blessing from the lesson that he has this evening. So I'll turn it over to Brother Crockett.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Pastor Winston, for this opportunity to share the Word of God with everybody. Before we get started, I just wanted to give glory to God for this time, and we're going to have a quick word of prayer, and then we'll dive right into the lesson. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time. We thank you for your Word. We thank you, Lord, that you use your Word to help teach us, help mold us, to help guide us, Father God. Right now, I ask that your Word would just go forth and accomplish what you want it to accomplish. I ask that you would just speak through me right now. Have your people learn something from your Word and have their hearts, their minds be changed, Father God. Help them to be encouraged by your Word this evening. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our lesson today is entitled Dealing with Distractions, and the text scripture is going to be coming from Matthew 13, verses 1 through 23, also known as the parable of the sower. So let's go ahead and get through reading that that scripture, and then we'll start going into the lesson. Matthew 13, 1 through 23. And the word of the Lord says, "The same day Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him, and he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, 'A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they were withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear." The disciples came to him and asked, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" He replied, "Because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven have been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, 'Who will be ever hearing but never understanding? You will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart have become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn, and I will heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears this message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed fallen among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed fallen on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces crop, yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. So we live in a world where distractions are all around us. We live in a time where we have information right at our fingertips. Many of us walk around with supercomputers right in our pockets at all times. And it's just in a few clicks, we can get any information that we want. We can reach anybody that we want. We can see anybody or see any video that we want to see. That's the world that we live in. And with that, having more and more and more information, more and more and more access, that means that we have more and more and more distractions. And it's not only just that we have more distractions, it's that we have these distractions at a younger age. My parents' generation, they did not receive their cell phones until they were in adulthood and had to buy their own. For me, I received my first cell phone when I was midway through my teenage years, and that cell phone could only call, text, and have one or two games and a calculator. That's all that that phone had. And nowadays, you have kids 9, 10, 11, 12 years old with basically a supercomputer in their pocket, and they are able to watch streaming, they're able to watch movies, they're able to access all of these different things, and they become attached to these things. And not only do they become attached, it's the world is pushing this on them at a younger and younger age. Whenever I go into Verizon with my twins, who are 4 years old, they try to upsell me to buy them a cell phone. They said it's perfect for long car rides so they can be distracted and not bother you during the ride. So we are pushing distractions at younger and younger and younger age. And the problem with that is distractions, sometimes you can think of them as good things. We talk about a welcome distraction at times. Sometimes you're going through something and you have a great day and it distracts you from whatever you've been going through in that moment. And that time, that's a welcome distraction to you. But for the most part, a distraction is something that's going to take your focus away from things that you need to have your focus on. So let's look at it. What is a distraction? Let's look at the definition of a distraction. And the Merriam-Webster definition is something that distracts, an object that directs one's attention away from something else. And if we look up what it means to be distracted, what does it mean to be distracted? Having one's thoughts or attention drawn away, unable to concentrate or give attention to something. So we look at that first definition, but when we move on to the second definition, this one is one that I found very, very interesting. It says, another definition for distracted is harassed, confused, or disturbed, especially by strong feelings. So what happens when you are distracted, where there are consequences to being distracted? As we see here in these definitions, you have a loss of focus. You have a loss of productivity. So there's plenty of times when you're at work and there's things that you know you're supposed to be doing, but then you get distracted by somebody who walks in, somebody who has a question, and you lose that productivity, you lose your focus, emotional distress. So a lot of times you get distracted, you lose that focus, you lose that productivity, and now you're thinking about, oh, now I'm up against the schedule. Now I'm up against the timeline. Now I'm stressing out because now I have all these extra things that I have to do now because I've been distracted for so long. I lost my focus. Another consequence of distraction is a loss of understanding or confusion. So you're trying to listen to something, you're in class, you're trying to learn, and all of a sudden your bestie is right behind you passing you a note, and you're reading the note. I guess they don't pass notes anymore. I guess your bestie will be texting you nowadays. I'm showing my age a little bit. So your bestie is texting you, and now you're not focused on what the teacher is saying, and the teacher calls you out. It always happens this way. When you're distracted, the teacher's going to call you and ask you a question, and now you're confused. You don't understand what's going on because you have been distracted. You've lost your focus in that moment. Loss of momentum. This is a major one, and this is something. It's funny how your lessons tend to pop up in your real life, because it seemed like every time when I would start to work on this lesson and start to get some momentum going and I'm really getting into it and things are just popping in my mind, I get a text message, a tweet pops up, something pops up, and I'm like, I gotta read it. It popped up on my phone and now I've lost momentum, right? And now I'm like, where was I? I gotta backtrack, you start over, and now you've lost momentum. And then in extreme cases, as you saw on one of the slides that I had, somebody was driving with that cell phone in their hands. And so in extreme cases, if you're distracted, a consequence of distraction could be a major injury or even loss of life as it causes you to get in an accident. So while there are some, you can say there are benefits to distractions, we see all of the consequences that come up with distractions. And that's just in your personal day-to-day life. But distractions are extremely powerful and can become extremely dangerous to your walk with Christ or to your relationship with Christ. Because once you begin to take your focus off of Christ, off of your Christian walk, off of the things of God, and begin to put your focus on other things, and you're distracted by the things of the world, that's when you start to run into some issues and you start to run into some difficulties in that relationship. And we see such a great example of this in our text scripture today in the parable of the sower, where we see different levels of quality of soil. And each one of those different levels of quality of soil reflect how our hearts can be when we're trying to receive the word of God. And I joke about this scripture because I feel like whenever this scripture has been brought up in the past at church, as somebody who grew up in the church, this is the you better pay attention in church scripture, right? It's the one that is always brought up in, hey, listen to this, or you don't want this to happen to you. And so I guess I've come around full circle to now I'm the one who's sharing the lesson about that. But it's not just about paying attention in church, but it's about how you pay attention, how you've prepared your heart to receive the things that God wants for you. Because it's you can be paying attention and listening and thinking that you're doing the things the way that you're supposed to be doing, but if your heart is not prepared, if your heart is distracted on the inside, we can't really tell on the outside what you're going through. So let's go ahead and start looking at this piece by piece, because there's different levels of the scripture that I want to break down. First is, and we talk about the parable of the sower, is the sower themselves. The sower themselves. So we look at our scripture in Matthew 13, 3 and 4, the A portion. And it says, "Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path." So when we talk about this, and we talk about the farmer, this part of the parable, as I always thought about it, I wouldn't say I struggled with it, but I wondered how much responsibility did the sower have in these seeds that fell on the wayside, or the seeds that did not grow the way that they were supposed to grow. Is it the sower's responsibility to make sure that the seeds go into good ground? And I realized it because I was thinking about it as, that's the sower being extremely wasteful if he's just letting his seeds be scattered everywhere that it can go, where it's not going to go to a place where it can grow in a good soil to harvest good fruit. He's wasting that seed. He's wasting that profit. And what the Lord revealed to me in the words is two things. It's one, it's what was the sower sowing? What was the seed? He was sowing the word of God in this parable. And the word of God has no limits. It's an unlimited resource. See, I was looking at it from the human perspective. Humans, we have boundaries. We have limited resources. We have things that we have to take in account for. We can't just let everything go whenever we want to. We have limits. But God is unlimited. And his word is unlimited. We can pass that word out to whomever, whenever, wherever, because we know that God has the ability through his seed to make good works and have good works grow from that. And the other thing that stood out to me is that it says, as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. And when I was looking into the scripture, one of the commentaries talked about that Jesus was utilizing the agricultural customs of that time. So at that time, they would scatter the seed first, and then they would plow it into the ground. So they just wanted to get it out there first to make sure that all of their seed got out into the ground, and then they would go in and actually plant the seed in the areas that it was going. So they weren't necessarily looking at where they were putting it at that time. They were just making sure that the seed got into the land that's around them. And that's the same way when we have our Christian walks. When we are walking and living the way that God wants us to live and doing the things that God wants us to do, we are a walking representation of his word. And that word is going to be spread amongst people. And sometimes it is going to fall by the wayside. Sometimes it is going to reach people who aren't necessarily at church because you're just living God's living your life the way God wants you to. And they're seeing that. And now that seed has been spread to them. And whether or not they are good soil is not up to you. It's still up to you to make sure that you plant the seed so that it has the opportunity to grow. And once you have planted the seed, now Jesus can do his work. God can do his work to make sure that it grows the way that it should and it develops the way that it should. So when we look at the parable of the sower in this moment represents us, but it also represents God's abundance, God's ability to have a limited amount of seeds to be able to pass out into this world so that people can be able to access the word of God. It's a reminder that we need to live life the way that Christ wants us to live, because we have the opportunity to multiply the effect of spreading the word out to other people by just living life the way that we should, because people see Christ in us. And so people are now able to encounter the word who might have never thought to step in church because they stepped into our path. And we were able to scatter that seed, even if it was by the wayside or along the path, as the scripture says. But let's talk about the wayside. Because the wayside is also representative of something. So when we look at 13:4, the B portion of it, it says, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. In other versions of the scripture, it says, some fell along the wayside. And when I think about the idea or the word, the wayside, when I looked up that word, the definition, it says, you know, the physical definition is of the wayside is, you know, all off the path, off the beaten path, right? But another definition of it is out of consideration or into a condition of neglect or disuse. And that out of consideration really hit me because it made me understand that when these seeds are being scattered by the wayside and there's people who are receiving them and the birds are automatically coming and eating them up, that means that that ground was not ready to accept those seeds. Those seeds were just sitting on top of the ground. And when we're passing or trying to talk to people about Christ or just living our life and people see Christ in us and those seeds just put themselves on top of the ground, it's not making any impact, those are people who most likely have taken themselves out of consideration to be able to accept the things of God, accept the things of Christ. There are people who have become so distracted by the enemy that their hearts are just so solid that the words cannot penetrate into them. They've taken themselves out of the consideration to receive that salvation that Christ is offering to everybody because they're so distracted. They're so worried about, well, if there is a God, then why is life the way that it is? They're so worried about if Jesus is so good, then why are there people starving? They're trying to find reasons not to believe in Christ. So they've hardened their hearts over time because of how the world is or because how they feel internally. And now they no longer are in consideration by themselves for receiving the seed. But the great thing is Jesus continues to keep them in consideration even when they try to take themselves out of the running. So Jesus has the ability to penetrate through that heart, but it's a difficult thing because they have hardened it and they just choose not to listen. When we look further at Jesus' explanation, why I really love this parable is because, you know, I don't have to do too much research because Jesus gives all the answers at the end of the test or the back of the book, right? So in 13:19, he says, when anyone hears this message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed that was sown along the path. So the seed is out in the open. It hasn't penetrated their heart. So it's very easy for the enemy, for life, for the world, for anything that is contrary to just come and take those words, those seeds, that word of God away from them. They don't think about it anymore. They're not worried about it anymore because their hearts have been so hardened. It didn't make any impact in them. And so the wayside, it represents those who have taken themselves out of consideration. They are no longer considering what a life with Christ would be like. As a matter of fact, they're distracted, but they're also focused. They've become so distracted by the enemy and the world that they are focused on the things that are not of God. And because they're focused on the things that are not of God, they don't have the ability to receive the things that are of God. And in that situation, now the enemy has taken their power. Because anytime they are coming in contact with Christ, it's just sitting on the surface. And they don't have any more power to be able to harvest those things, to learn, to grow, to change. And unfortunately, this scenario is the hardest to come back from because they have hardened their hearts so much. They don't want to understand. They don't want to be saved. They just want to be left alone. But as I said before, just because they take themselves out of the consideration, it does not mean that Christ takes them out of the consideration, because he will always consider us as long as we are on this side of eternity. As we move on to the next section, so this is the soil of the rocky place. And this one is the one that I would say it was the one that was kind of cutting for me, because I know I have been there in this situation. And you know, when you do Bible studies, as you learn, a lot of times you're teaching yourself. and sometimes you gotta tell yourself, ouch. But the rocky place, Matthew 13:5-6 says, some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. So this one talks about distraction, but it talks about it in a very interesting way. Or I picked up on it in a very interesting way. I look at these individuals. When we go actually further on, let's actually go further on and see how Jesus explains it. It says, the seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. I look at this individual as somebody who comes into church looking for an emotional connection or emotional revival, and nothing more. So they come into church. It might have been they've been going through something, and I have been guilty of this. You come into church, you've been going through something, it's been a rough week, whatever the case may be. You're feeling sad, you're feeling emotional, you're in an emotional, vulnerable space, and you're at church. And you come in, and the songs, oh man, the songs all sound great, and you're crying through praise and worship, and then the word comes, and the word is exactly what you needed to hear, and it's perfect, and you feel uplifted, and you feel encouraged, and then you get outside the church, you go home, you take your nap, and by the time you wake up, you feel the same way that you felt before. Or you get a text message that reminds you of the state of life that you're in at that moment. And that's because you went with a joyful heart. You went with an open heart to receive something, but it did not get any root. It did not get deep enough into your heart, into your spirit, because you weren't actually going to learn or grow closer to God. You were going to be relieved from the emotional distress that you had felt in that moment. And so you got that momentary relief. It's like getting a Band-Aid or you have a headache, you take a Tylenol. But eventually that headache comes back. Eventually those symptoms comes back when you take some medicine. You went to church to get medicine that day. And as soon as the harvest starts to come, the plants aren't deep enough. So now once those plants are out in the elements, now you're outside of the walls of the church and you don't have that emotional connection anymore. And the sun comes, now those plants are starting to wither away. Because you haven't planted it deep enough in your heart. You were distracted by your own emotions. You were distracted by your own situation. You were distracted by what you were going through. So your focus wasn't on God. Your focus was on yourself, and you were using God as a pick-me-up to get you past that emotional barrier. And God is not just a pick-me-up. He is your companion. He's the one that you need to rely on. He's the one that you need to be able to put those things in his hands. It's not just about making you feel better when you walk in the doors. It's about taking those things and giving those burdens to Christ, because he's the one who can handle it and you're the one who cannot. But what you're really doing is you're just trying to cover up the symptoms. You're taking NyQuil to make sure that you can sleep through the night so you can make it to another day. But taking NyQuil is not going to heal you. Taking NyQuil is just going to make you comfortable in that moment. So if you're coming to church just to be comfortable, you're coming for the wrong reasons. And the word, the seed that's being sowed to you in that moment is not going to be able to take root deep enough to actually make a difference the way that you would want it to. You have to have your heart opened and ready to receive it and ready to change, not just to feel better. So when we look at the rocky place, this represents a heart that is a shallow connection to the word or to Jesus. So your connection to it is about how you feel and not about what it's saying or what it's asking for you to do. It's usually receiving or listening from an emotionally vulnerable place. So you're listening because you want to feel better, but are you really ready to change? Are you really ready to pull yourself out of whatever situation that you're in? Are you ready to give that situation to God? Are you ready to actually let that seed harvest and take root? Because a lot of times you are letting that seed go in there, and then the seed is harvesting and it's saying, well, actually, to get better, you need to cut this person off. Or actually, to get better, you need to remove yourself from the situation. Or actually, to get better, you need to put that thing away. And then you're like, oh, no, that's not what I wanted. I just wanted to feel better, right? So it's also distracted by one. These people are distracted, or this heart is distracted by wanting relief from their circumstances. So they're not focused on the substance of what they're receiving. They're not focused on what the scripture is actually saying, because a lot of times I have heard plenty of feel good sermons, and I could not tell you the next day any of the points that were in the sermon, because in that moment it just made me feel good. But there have been sermons where I did not feel good listening to them, but that was because I was being rebuked, I was being, taught, I was learning something about myself, and I realized, oh, I have to make some changes because of this sermon, not just feel good and feel on a high, because it's not about being a speech to make you, to pump you up like you're about to go play the big game. It's about, no, you need to learn, you need to change, you need to be better. And then this harvest is not built to withstand the elements. It's not built to withstand the troubles of the world. It's not deep enough to take real root. So as soon as things happen that are negative, as soon as things happen that aren't according to plan, that's when you're going to start to see that harvest wither away, like it says in under the weight of the sun, under the heat of the sun, these plants were scorched because they had no root. And what I really like is in Luke, this parable is also told in Luke. It said that these plants lacked moisture, the water of life. It lacked the thing that actually would allow it to live beyond just growing up, growing out of the ground. So a lot of times, if we're not allowing that seed to root inside of us, it's lacking moisture. It's lacking the thing that's going to make it grow and last beyond just a few days. Let's move on to the next one, the thorny place. Matthew 13:7 and Matthew 13:22. It says, other seeds fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. And Jesus' explanation says, the seed fallen among the thorns refer to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. So this one is the classic definition of a distraction, right? You've had this seed rooted in your heart, and it's growing, but other things are growing with it. One of the commentaries said that these people have fertile soil, but the soil is too fertile, because you're taking things in. You're taking in the word of God, but you're also taking in your friends' opinions, and you're also taking in your family's opinions, and you're also taking in what you're reading in social media. You're also taking in what you're seeing on the news. You're also taking in all of your worries, all of your guilt, all of that. It all grows inside of your heart. And it's too fertile. Too many things are growing. So the good and the bad are growing in this moment. And so it's growing up. It's growing up, and so these plants are growing. You know, you get the word, and you're learning. You're trying to change. You're trying to do better. You're trying to be good. But then something comes up, and it takes your focus away. But then, you know, you get a bill, and you're thinking, oh, man, I got to worry about this bill. I can't come to church anymore and pay my tithe and offering. I got to worry about this bill. You know, something comes up on social media. You feel like you're being bullied, and you think, I can't show my face anymore. Something comes up at work. Something happens here. Something happens here. And it starts to grow, and it starts to weed out those times when you need to be reaching out to God. You start to withdraw yourself. It chokes out the things that you have learned in those moments because your heart is so open, but it's open to everything. And so these individuals, they have an open heart. But as I mentioned, it allows everything in, everything in. And these people easily become distracted by the cares of the world. As we talked about in the actual definition of distractions, it takes your focus away from things that your focus needs to be on. And in this case, your focus, whenever things are going wrong, whenever things are going right, no matter what, your focus needs to be on God, because God is the one who's able to handle and help you handle those things. But when you're so easily distracted by what's going on in the world, whether it's good or bad, because a lot of times people stop coming to church because things are getting good too. You know, things are getting good. They're having a good time. They're making money. And no, I don't need to go to church anymore. My life is great. What do I need to go to church for? You get distracted. That's where Jesus talks about wealth, the deceitfulness of wealth. In that moment, everything is going good. You're being deceived by the idea that because things are going good here on earth, in this world, this physical world, that means things are going good spiritually for you and emotionally for you and mentally for you. But those things pass away. Wealth passes away. Looks pass away. But the seeds, the harvest of Christ, the seeds, the harvest of God, those things last forever. They have no end. And then the last one, as I mentioned before, allows the distractions to overtake the harvest, the word. So it takes time away from God. Once you start to allow the things of the world to come in and grow amongst the harvest of God, you begin to move your focus away from, I can't make it this time because I got to do this. Or, you know, my kid's gymnastics class is 7:30, so I'm not able to make it to Bible study anymore. Those things start to take precedent because you are being distracted by the cares of the world, and it allows you to take time away from God. The last one here is good soil. The good soil. Matthew 13:8. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop 160 or 30 times what was sown. And 13:23 says, and this is Jesus' explanation, but the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. So this is the type of soil that we should be striving to be. This is the way our hearts should be when we are taking in and listening to the word of God. This is a person who has an open heart that is only focused on the Lord. So your heart is ready and open to be able to grow and have a harvest, but you're not going to allow weeds or thorns or anything that's not of God to take root inside of your heart. You're only going to allow the things that are of God to take root and grow from you. This is a person whose heart has the ideal conditions for the word to grow. So these are people who aren't focused on themselves. They're focused on the kingdom, and they're focused on how can I take what I'm learning, apply it to my life, and help apply it to other people so that they can see these seeds grow. And that's why you see it says it multiplies. And Jesus says 160 or 30 times what was sown. So when we allow our hearts to be in the proper conditions for Jesus to be able to plant those seeds, for the word of God to grow within us, now it multiplies and now it's reaching other people. And now it takes us all the way back to the beginning, and now we become the sower. Because we have this harvest inside of us that is producing seeds that we are able to then pass along to other people. And then they can pass along to other people, and it can continue to multiply outside and beyond us. That's why we have to always be aware that distractions don't just affect us. Distractions can affect all of those who are around us. Because if we're distracted from the things of God, there might be somebody who's down the line that we're not aware of, who don't have that contact with God that they were supposed to have, because we were supposed to grow the seed that God put inside of us. We have to understand that when we talk about multiply, it multiplies beyond us and then beyond us and then beyond us. And that's where we get to the 100, the 60, the 30 times of what was put in there. So I love this explanation. I love the parable of the sower, but we have to be able to practically understand and see when distractions can't affect us. Because it's not just enough for me to tell you, hey, these are all these things and you need to not be distracted and you need to be focused. But we need to be able to talk about and apply how can we do some of these things. So how do we deal with distractions? How can we deal with distractions? First, we need to identify our distractions. And this is a list that I put together, but everybody's list might be different. But these are some things that I put. Social media, phone, TV, tablet. Those are obvious ones. And sometimes they're not so obvious. The other day, I like to play like brain teaser games before I go to bed. It helps to relax me. So I'll do like a word search or solitaire or do a jigsaw puzzle. And I'm also competitive. So like if I get one done, I'm like, oh, maybe I can do another one quick, or I can do another one quick. And I'm looking, I'm going through, and I'm like, what time is it? I feel like I've been doing this for a long time. And I look, each of these apps, they hide the time in the top left-hand corner, so you don't even know how long you're on these things, right? So it becomes a distraction for you, and you get lost in it. And I realized I was spending like 30 minutes playing jigsaw puzzles when I should have been going to bed for work the next day. But that's how distractions can get to you, because you even get distracted from the fact that it is a distraction. Other individuals, you know, this one goes without saying. It's the significant other. It's the friend who says, you know, we can just go out and have one drink, right? The person who's constantly getting you to take your focus off the things that you need to be doing and put your focus somewhere else. Vices, bad habits. Purposeful, hectic schedule. So there's a lot of people who put their schedule before everything else. And they do it purposefully so that they don't have time to do anything else or to do things that they think that they're supposed to do. So it's the classic, this meeting could have been an email type of person, right? It's a person who, I need to look busy, I need to look like I'm doing a lot of things, but they're really just distracting themselves from the things that they actually need to be doing. And then the last one, is sleeping, resting, or napping. And, you know, some people are going to be like, oh man, I need my sleep. And I'm with you. I like to sleep. I like to take a nap. But, you know, the Bible talks about this. There's Proverbs 24, 33, and 34. And this is the Message translation. And I really like this one. It says, a nap here, a nap there, a day off here, a day off there. Sit back, take it easy. Do you know what comes next? Just this. You can look forward to a dirt poor life with poverty as your permanent house guest. That's cold-blooded right there. But it's true. You know, it's okay to take naps. You need to have rest. But I know, you know, there's 24 hours in the day. And if I take a two-hour nap on top of knowing I'm going to have 8 hours of sleep, that's almost half my day spent to sleeping that I could be doing something else. And sleeping can very well be a distraction. We see this in Matthew 26, 40 and 41. Then he returned to the disciples and found them asleep. And he said to Peter, couldn't you watch with me even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the body is weak. So when we start to allow the things of our body, the desires of our body, it's the same thing where you're working and you just have to keep going up and getting a snack. You start to get distracted from doing the things that you're supposed to do because you're so focused on self. So it's not to shame anybody from taking naps or going to sleep or saying that you don't need to do that. But it's saying you have to do everything in moderation to make sure that you're not taken away from the things that you're supposed to be doing. But while you're identifying distractions, you have to understand that there is a difference between something being a distraction and something being distracting, right? So a distraction is something that is consistently taking your focus away from important items or work. Something that's distracting is something that temporarily takes away your focus from important items or work. I work from home. I work remotely. And my children are still young, so they're home most of the time while I'm at working. And it never fails. When I am in a meeting, a very, very important meeting with very, very important people, I'm in a meeting and I hear it comes up like a rumble. That toy was mine. I had that one first. And then, no, I had that one first. And then you hear like scuffle. And that's when I know it's about to be trouble. And then you hear, ah, and one of my kids are screaming or whining or yelling right outside my door. It always happens right outside my door. Even though I have a noise canceller, you can still hear that screaming in the background. And then you hear, he hit me, she pushed me. And it's just loud, loud ruckus. And in this moment, I have become distracted from this meeting. I'll be lucky if I heard anything that the person said in the meeting because I'm thinking, okay, can they hear me? Can they hear this over the mic? What's going on? Do I have to come out there? Are they going to come try to open the door? And now they're going to be on the camera and also screaming in the background. So all of these things, and I'm not thinking about what's happening in that meeting in that moment. That is distracting, but that does not mean that my kids are a distraction. Because my kids need my attention at times. It's just in that moment, they can't get it. But they will always need my attention because they are my children. See, there's some things that can be distracting to you. Like some people have pets. Their pets can be distracting. Your pet needs your attention. But it's not always at that moment. That means that in that moment, they're distracting, but they're not a distraction. So don't try to use that as an excuse to say, oh, I had to push out distractions. That means I need to spend less time with my pets or whatever the case may be. No, it's distracting in that moment, but that's something that needs your attention, just not in that moment. Whereas distractions are something that you can give your attention, but it's not essential. It doesn't need your attention at all times or really ever. It's just something that might be extra. A distraction, a lot of times, is something that you actively seek out to distract you. Whereas something that's distracting is usually, you know, normally something that you're not actively seeking out. It's just they decide to get in a fight right outside your door when you're in an important meeting. So examples of this is, you know, as a distraction, it's phone, social media, YouTube, things that we talked about earlier. Whereas distracting are children, pets, work. So, you know, my work can be distracting, but, you know, it's not a distraction. I need to work. I need to do the things that I need to do. It's just everything needs to happen in its appropriate time. Another distinction that we need to have is the difference between distraction and temptation. And to talk about that, we're going to talk about, you know, one of the more famous, I can say this, womanizers that you will find in the Bible. And that's Samson. And we look at Judges. I'm going to read through Judges 16, 1 through 21, 22, sorry, that talks about his downfall, and then we'll sort of break it down as we go through it. So it says, one day Samson went to Gaza, where he saw a prostitute. He went in to spend the night with her, and the people of Gaza were told, Samson is here. So they surrounded the place and lay in wait for him all night at the city gate. They made no move during the night, saying, at dawn we'll kill him. But Samson lay there only until the middle of the night. Then he got up and took hold of the doors of the city gate together with the two posts, and tore them loose, bar and all. He lifted them over his shoulders and carried them to the top of the hill that faced Hebron. Sometime later, he fell in love with a woman in the valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah. And the rulers of the Philistines went to her and said, "See if you can lure him into showing you the secret of his great strength and how we can overpower him so we may tie him up and subdue him. And each one of us will give you 1,100 shekels of silver." So we see here, Samson, we can tell, has a woman problem in this way, where he goes to see a prostitute. We already know, hey, that's bad. You shouldn't be going to see a prostitute. And going to see this prostitute almost got him in trouble. But because of his great strength, he was able to get himself out of it. So, sure, go back. There we go. So, you know, he's already seen the effect of this possible distraction getting him in trouble. It says, sometime later, he fell in love with a woman of the Valley of Sork, who was Delilah. And scholars, as I was looking into this, believe she was also, you know, harlot or prostitute. There's no evidence besides the fact that, you know, he just saw a prostitute before this earlier in the scripture. And also, she's getting paid now later to try to tempt him and seduce him to get his weakness. So, you know, we can already see that that's a temptation. If this was a prostitute, you're not supposed to be going to do that. However, even if she wasn't a prostitute, you need to be wary and understand what situation you are putting yourself in. He has already seen that he can be distracted by a woman, by a beautiful woman, and that distraction can get him into trouble, and that he can also be tempted by a beautiful woman, and that temptation will get him into trouble, right? But he has not learned from it. He continues on. So we see later, so Delilah said to Samson, "Tell me the secret of your great strength and how you can be tied up and subdued." Samson answered her, "If anyone ties me with 7 fresh bowstrings that have not been dried, I'll become as weak as any other man." Then the rulers of the Philistines brought her 7 fresh bowstrings that had not been dried, and she tied him with them. And when men hidden in the room, she called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." But he snapped the bowstrings as easily as a piece of string snaps when it comes close to a flame. So the secret of his strength was not discovered. Then Delilah said to Samson, "You have made a fool of me. You lied to me. Come now and tell me how you can be tied." And he said, "If anyone ties me securely with new ropes that have never been used, I'll become as weak as any other man." So Delilah took new ropes and tied him with them. Then with men hidden in the room, she called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." But he snapped the ropes off his arms as if they were threads. And Delilah then said to Samson, "At this time you have been making a fool of me and lying to me. Tell me how you can be tied." And he replied, "If you weave the 7 braids of my head in the fabric on the loom and tighten it with the pin, I'll become as weak as any other man." So while he was sleeping, Delilah took the 7 braids of his head, wove them into a fabric, and tightened them with the pin. And again she called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." He awoke from his sleep and pulled the pin and loom with the fabric. So let's stop here really quickly. She gave him 3 chances to get out of this situation, but he was blinded by his temptation. Temptation has a way of distracting you from the things that you need to see. He knew enough to lie to her, right? So he understood she was doing something that wasn't for his benefit, but yet he continued to stay in that situation and allow that temptation. And finally, then she said to him, "How can you say I love you when you won't confide in me? This is the 3rd time you have made a fool of me and haven't told me the secret of your great strength." With such nagging, she prodded him day after day until he was sick to death of it. So he told her everything. "No razor has ever been used on my head," he said, "because I have been a Nazarite dedicated to God from my mother's womb. If my head were shaved, my strength would leave me and I would become as weak as any other man." And when Delilah saw that he had told her everything, she sent word to the rulers of the Philistines, "Come back once more. He has told me everything." So the rulers of the Philistines returned with the silver in their hands. After putting him to sleep on her lap, she called for someone to shave off the 7 braids of his hair, and so began to subdue him, and his strength left him. And then he called Then she called Samson, the Philistines are upon you. He awoke from his deep sleep and thought, I'll go out as before and shake myself free. But he did not know what the Lord had left him. And then the Philistines seized him, gouged his eyes out, and took him down to Gaza, binding him with bronze shackles. And they set him grinding grain in the prison. But his hair on his head began to grow after it had been shaved. So here's the thing. Every temptation is a distraction, but not every distraction is a temptation. So there are times where you can have a distraction, but it's not going to lead you to sin or to doing wrong, right? But temptation is there to distract you. It's not only there to distract you from the things of God, but it's also there to distract you from the fact that you're being tempted. And we saw this in Samson. He had to know that there was something wrong because he kept continually lying and lying and lying to Delilah. So eventually he just allowed himself to be in that situation so long, he gave up his very strength. And that's what temptation does to you if you don't remove yourself from it. You'll stay in it too long and you think, I can handle this thing. And then all of a sudden, next thing you know, you're waking up bald and you're in trouble because you've given up your power. And that's the thing. Distractions do not always lead to sin. Satan can have a place in your life as long as you do it moderately. It does not always have to be completely removed. It's designed to take your focus away, but not exclusively from God. It's designed just to take your focus away from everything. But temptation, it leads to sin. It has no place in your life. You need to remove yourself from its presence, or it must be removed if it's an object. It's designed to take your focus from God. So what do? We've identified our distractions. We understand the difference between distractions and temptations. So next thing is we need to increase our focus. Matthew 13, 9 and 16 says, whoever has ears, let him hear. But blessed are your eyes, because they see, and your ears, because they hear. Seeing and hearing requires focus. I went on a date with my wife recently. We went to a restaurant, very nice restaurant. I sat down at the restaurant. I looked up, and there was a 60-inch TV screen with the Golden State Warrior game on. And in that moment, seeing and hearing my wife required some focus because I had a big distraction behind me, right? It required, and the same thing with the Word of God, it requires focus. When you want to see and truly listen to somebody, you can't be on your phone, you can't be thinking about other things, you have to allow yourself to focus on that thing. So you have to increase your focus. You know, we'll talk about, Jesus goes on and talks about why he uses parables, because parables allow you to focus. Matthew 13, 10 through 15, I'll just speak here on, this is why, on 13, we'll skip down to 13, or we'll go to 11. He replied, because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven have been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear. So the word of God is there, but you have to be able to focus on it. You can't just allow that thing to roll right off your shoulder or roll right off your back. It requires focus, and that's why it can be difficult for some because they're not able to focus and understand what's going on. So the word is designed to touch those who have a heart that's not distracted. The more you focus on the Lord, as we see here, you'll get more, the more he pours into you. And do not be in God's presence to be seen, but not there to focus and understand. And do not let the ambitions of the world distract you from God's word. So here's the practical application of that. Matthew 18, 8 and 9. Talks about, if your hand or foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life maimed or crippled than have two hands and two feet and be thrown into eternal fire. And if your eyes cause you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than have two eyes and be thrown into the fire of hell. So here, you have to determine if you can properly keep a distraction in check. So are you able to put that thing aside and use it when it's supposed to be used? If not, then you need to completely remove that item from your life. This is a very, very severe explanation that we get here from Jesus, and it's extreme, but it's an extreme analogy to convey the extreme importance of removing sin from your life. You need to be able to create a plan and stick to it. Set aside appropriate times to engage in these distractions so that this thing is no longer a distraction, but it's a time of recreation. So we have to be able to focus on God. That's the only way we can get past these distractions. And then here are some quick scriptures that I want to share with you that talks about how to focus on God. Colossians 3:2 says, set your mind on the things above, not on earthly things. 1 Corinthians 7:35, and this is Paul. This is in Paul's explanation of why you should be a single person to be for God. Now, of course, I'm not a single person, but the reason why he brought that up was he's saying that I am saying this for your own good, not to restrict you, but that you may live in a right way in an undivided devotion to the Lord. And that's the same thing with distractions. We're not here to restrict you, but we want you to be able to devote yourself to the Lord. We have 1 Peter 5:8. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Hebrews 12:2. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Matthew 6:33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you as well. Proverbs 4:25. Let your eyes look straight ahead and fix your gaze directly before you. And Proverbs 3:6. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Thank you so much for this time. God bless you.
Amen. Amen. That was a wonderful, wonderful lesson. And thank you, Brother Dari, for doing that. I'm sure each and every one of you have received a blessing this evening for tuning into the Word. He had lots of slides on there. And if you would like a copy of the PowerPoint presentation, you could email me at cornell.h.winston@gmail.com, and I could forward those PowerPoint slides to you. You know, you may want to, some of you were distracted in the midst of the lesson. You may want to rewind it and play it again and have that PowerPoint next to you so you could write notes on it. I wrote notes on mine just to make sure I caught what was the word of God being. I really caught what was being taught. So we encourage you to do that. Email me at cornell.h.winston@gmail.com. Next week, we'll continue in our series we started last week here in this Lenten season entitled, Who is Near the Cross? And next week, we're going to look at Peter, who was close to the cross, but he was still far away. So I invite you to join me next week for that lesson. And also, I'm inviting you to worship with us here at Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship. There is a seat here just for you. There's several special services that are going to be going on here in the month of March during this season. On Good Friday, March 29th, we'll have our Good Friday service. There'll be a dramatic presentation. We'll be observing the Lord's Supper, remembering what that Friday meant and how that relates to our salvation. So that service begins at 6:30, and I'm inviting you to come and join with us here. Also on Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, we'll have two services, our normal 8 a.m. service, but the second service will be at 11 instead of 10 a.m. as our normal time is. So we invite you to come join us on Resurrection Sunday, 8 o'clock or 11 o'clock. And if you come from 9 to 10:30, we'll be serving breakfast. So it'll be a full breakfast. It's just not a little skimpy, you know, pastry and a glass of juice, but a full breakfast. So you're invited. It won't cost you anything, but getting up and coming to church, that is something that we can't do online. We can't send you a plate virtually. No, you'll have to come and partake in person. So we're inviting you, as well as every Sunday here at Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship. This next Sunday, our service is at 8 and 10, our normal time. And again, Good Friday at 6:30, March 29th, and Resurrection Sunday, March 31st, our services are 8 and 10. So again, God bless you. God keep you. Thank you for joining here in this virtual space And I pray and I know that this lesson was a blessing. So let's pray and we'll conclude. Father, again, we just say thank you for how you love us so. Lord, help us to be focused on you, to dismiss those distractions that may choke the word that's trying to get into our hearts. Lord, help us to produce that seed that's been planted. Father, I thank you for Brother Dari. Lord, strengthen him. Lord, return back to him. Lord, those hours that he put in for this lesson. Lord, we thank you for each and every one that's tuned in this evening or whenever they may join this study. Lord, thank you that we love you so much and we want our lives to be better that we join in for Bible study. So, Lord, thank you for what you've done for us, in us, and through us. Keep us in your care. Allow us to tune in next week. Allow us to come to service. Lord, just to be able to celebrate how good you have been to each and every one of us. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. God keep you. Looking forward to seeing you again. Have a blessed week.